like something that would be. My husband and I, we always prefer to have it cut. The carpet soup. The soup will be there. She cannot wrap her head around it. And I told her, even I was shocked in the beginning. Did, you know, check. But now I'm used to it. Sometimes you may need to check if they have any, like, this is non-existent where I come from. To your new job. As it's supposed to. Sends us super chat and super thanks. Thank you so much to you all. And also all our exclusive members. We have the exclusive members club. If you would like to join, a join button next to our name each on every one of our videos, so you can just click join. We post exclusive content on there. I just posted a video last night, so if you'd like to check it out, please feel free to join. school or high school or even the first years of college, it's pretty common that they will bring their girlfriend and just take them to their room and shut the door, and the parents won't bat an eyelash. That really struck me as so odd. Some of these things I ask my husband. When I read them or when I sit down with fellow experts or foreigners or immigrants, whichever name you'd like to refer, people like me as, and most of them are like, oh yeah, this happens a lot. Oh yeah, I've seen this happen. And we're like, wow. Especially people from Africa, they always like wonder how this is acceptable, that the parents will not say anything to a boy bringing home a girl, and also like a girl bringing home a boy, and they just go to the bedroom and you don't even know what they're doing in there. And so that really shocked me. I've never seen anything like it. It was a massive shock, to say the least. I guess it has more to do with, you know, parents here. What I've noticed here is most parents, after the kids pass a certain age, they really do not care about parenting anymore. They're like, my work is done. You know, they do not want to put in any more effort. So the kids end up really being raised mostly by the system, the school system, which we all know, most cases it's not that great. In most of Africa, this would be unheard of. So that's really like something that would be like a taboo. If when I was in primary school, I would bring a boy home and say, oh, this is my boyfriend, and go up to the room and close the door. That would be like the most absurd thing, you know, that would never, I can't even imagine it, because it would just never happen, you know, not with me, not with my peers, or with anyone I know, you know. So this was really a culture shock for me. And also, on that topic, I have to say that when I first got here, I went to a clinic. It is recommended that all women living here, I don't know if it's in all European countries, but it is recommended that you see a doctor, a gynecologist. Do they call them OBGYN? I don't know. But yeah, a doctor for a checkup once or twice a year. No, if you're fine, you know, if you have anything like, you know, female related illnesses, and just to check your well-being, you know, sometimes you may need to check if they have any like ovarian cancer and these things. So anyway, when I got here, 3 months after, I had to register at a clinic, find a gynecologist. And the only one that I could find that could speak English was a man, and I really didn't want him, you know, touching me in my intimate parts. So I always asked, can the nurse just do it instead of you? And he was totally fine with it. But the very beginning, I remember, he called my husband in and he told my husband that I didn't want to be checked, that the checkup is compulsory. And I told my husband that it's not that I don't want anyone to touch me, I just don't want him to insert anything in there, you know. And yeah, from then on, he started asking the nurse to check me as he was right there, you know. He not ready to have any kids, you know. Anyway, so the doctor tells me after that one checkup, after the nurse checked me, I don't know why you're so afraid of being checked down there. Girls who are half your age, 11, they're already very active, you know, in what? I don't know if I'm allowed to say on an asthma video. You know the word I'm trying to say, right? Yeah, they're very, that word, active. By the time they're 11 and they come here, I give them contraceptive, I check them, and it's like, you've never been on contraceptive? And I'm like, no. And it's like, that is wild. Girls of your age, I've already been on them for like 1-2 years already. My mind was blown. I was literally so shocked. My jaw was on the floor. I had not never had anything like that. That girls 11, 12 are already very active in that area, and they're already on contraceptive. I mean, that's crazy. To be honest, I never want to put myself, my child, on a contraceptive that early, you know. There's so many side effects that come with taking contraceptive, you know. Especially at such a young age, I can only imagine. When you're older, you get crazy side effects. Now imagine when you're 11. It's crazy. It's crazy. Discussing it with my husband is like, but parents do it here because they don't want their girls to get pregnant very early. That's why they choose to put them on their contraceptive so early, because they're already active in that area so soon. And I'm like, what kind of parenting? I know I can't blame it all on the parents, because also most of the time the kids are in school, but OMG, that was really crazy. Streets of Prague, the capital, you will see a lot of dog poop in the streets, because most people don't pick up after their dog. It's so disheartening when you are doing it, like my husband and I, we do it religiously, but there's so many people that don't do it. So so crazy walking and seeing so much poop in the streets. So yeah, this is one thing that really astonished me, how so many people have pets, dogs as pets, and how people didn't pick after their dog, you know, and the poop was everywhere. It's not something I expected to see in a first world country. So I was really shocked. most people hear about Africa, the first thing they think about is the craziness in the markets, the people walking around, talking loudly, basically the disorganization, the kind of no order lifestyle that most African countries, you know, practice. I was pretty much shocked when I got here and I saw that the drums and the buses all have a timetable and they arrive at exactly that time, you know. This really shocked me because this is non-existent where I come from. If the bus is supposed to come at 10:30, best believe it will be there at 10:30. It might be late by 1 or 2 minutes, but that's it. It will be there as it's supposed to. Same thing applies to a tram. Sometimes they do get late, but just by a minute or two and not more. If of course there's an accident on the road, yeah, of course there will be a longer delay. But yeah, the fact that they have timetables that are on schedule was crazy to me, because when you enter public transport, you do not leave unless it's full. It doesn't matter if you're in a hurry. And I can remember the times that we didn't have Uber. So if you're going for an important meeting and you don't want to be late, you would have to take such an expensive taxi or border. And you all arrive there all disheveled and sweaty. Also the fact that the border, which is a motorcycle, as a public transport, they do not give you a helmet. They only, some of them wear a helmet, some don't. So if you're both to fall, best believe you'll get hurt, you know, one way or the other. Crazy, right? So, the public display of affection really blew my mind here. The fact that people are in the streets just openly kissing or touching inappropriately, and that was a shocker to me, I have to say. In my country, it's actually seen as like obscene or something that's very immoral to do this in public. Even just holding hands, up until recently, you would not see people holding hands. Of course, now things have changed, but that's not something that was, you know, seen as acceptable to do, you know, kissing, holding hands, or holding the waist. Of course, maybe people do this in a kind of a party setting, but not in the city, you know, not in the tram station or bus stop or in the supermarket. You wouldn't see this. And I was very shocked to see it so open, like in your face kind of way. When I first got here, you know. And also the dressing. I was a little taken aback by the dressing too. The fact that people, especially in the summer, it's always the time that you see people wearing close to nothing. And you're like, when I showed my auntie, who's very, you know, she lives in the village, she's very traditional, she doesn't go to the capital city, Nairobi, so often. So sometimes I show her pictures of how people dress here and she screams every time. And I told her when she comes to visit me, she'll be expected to dress like this. And she always gets so shocked and she says she won't come. I'm usually just playing with her. But she's like, she cannot wrap her head around it. And I told her, was quite different from where I come from. Culturally. The fact that the rich and the poor, all of them live in like the same size of house. Of course, in rich people's houses, they have better appliances in the house. You know, the houses are updated, like, you know, the paint is not falling off the wall and stuff like that. But yeah, you'll find like a rich family of five, they live in a 3+1 bedroom house. And it's not that big. And also, the poor live in the same size of house. That really kinda was something I couldn't understand, because I come from the rich live in big mansions and the poor live in very small houses. But here, in most cases, you'll find that successful doctors, surgeons, and you know, affluent people, they also live in you know, a 2-bedroom or 3-bedroom. Some of them don't live in the same neighborhood, but I'm talking about the size of the house, you know, the most common sizes. You will find that there are some rich people that live in villas. They call them villa. A 4 or 5 bedroom house that's standing alone is called a villa here, you know. When I heard of villas, I thought it's like a 10 bedroom big mansion, but no, a villa here in Czech Republic is a 4 or 5 bedroom house that's standing alone. And even with that, the rooms inside are not as big. They are very cramped up, you know. I've seen a couple of villas and they're not as big. You know, quite small rooms in there. When I was talking about the bureaucracy in this country in the previous video, I don't know if I mentioned that you also need to have a doctor's letter among the documents that you'll bring to your new job. Yeah, once you get the job, they tell you that we will need you to come on your first day when you report to work to bring a doctor's note. They will check your blood and they will check other things, and you'll bring that document that the doctor gives you with you on your first day of work. Isn't that wild? It's like the most absurd thing you would say to someone. Coming from my country especially, because they just don't care about these things. And I know they are important, but they just, you know, it's just something that you'll never be asked for. Reporting to work, where I come from. I know I've spoken a whole lot about the holidays, how we celebrate them back home. Christmas, Easter, you know. And how, I don't know if I mentioned before how they celebrate Christmas here. But for those that are new, or for those that want to hear it again, Christmas here is celebrated on the 24th night, not 25th. The official day, Christmas Day, is 24th. Yeah. Crazy, I know. I couldn't understand it when I first got here. I was like, what do people do on the 25th? Apparently on the 25th, Christmas is done. They have lunch, but it's not major, you know. And it's not a big deal. The big deal is 24th. That's when it's full-blown Christmas. That's when family is celebrating. That's when the kids open the presents on 24th night after the dinner. So basically, the dinner is the main meal that family sits together. consisted of carp fish, they call it their capper, and potato salad. So the carp fish is usually quite big. They start selling it around 23rd of December. And people buy it and take it home live, some people. And for those that do not know how to, you know, remove the scales and stuff, they get it chopped and remove scales and cut the intestines removed and stuff. We always prefer to have it cut us, because no one in this family wants to do the job of, you know, cutting it. My husband doesn't like to, you know, chop the head and stuff like that. It's all so gory. But some people do. And when they take it live, they take it in a bucket with water, and then they put it in the bathtub and give it water until like 24th morning, when they start to make the carpet soup. The soup will be the starter of the Christmas dinner. And then they will eat some fried fish and some fried chicken, which is commonly called the schnitzel. And then they might throw in there some bread or some fries or potatoes, like oven baked potatoes, something like that. And then they'll eat the potato salad. It's quite crazy, you know. And then Christmas is over. They open, the kids open the presents, and then they go to sleep, and the next morning Christmas is done, technically. I was so surprised about this. I thought it was only Czechs who do it, but my husband told me there are other European countries that